The next speaker is Roberto Lineros, from the Universidad Católica del Norte. And there's the title, please, Roberto.
Okay, thank you very much, Marat, and also thanks to organizer, and I'd like to congratulate all the organizers for very nice workshop. Also, I couldn't be in all the part because I have to teach another stuff. But anyway, I remember when I was a master's student in the Universidad Católica de Chile, I was also coming here to Afunalwe. So I don't know after so many years how is the place, but it's a very nice to be here. I mean, virtually in the workshop when I was master's student. So anyway, so the talk I'm going to, I mean the topic I want to tell you is a model of dark matter with dark matter in a connected with radiative seesaw or a mechanism to give mass to neutrinos. So in that sense, this is a work that is in collaboration with Matías Pierre from the Instituto de Física Teórica in Universidad Autónoma de Madrid. And there is the archive number if you want to check it out. So anyway, first of all, what is the idea of my talk is basically a brief introduction why dark matter and neutrinos may be a good candidate to be La Parte and El Todo in my talk at least. And after that, some explanation how they could be connected. And especially I'm gonna make focus on this model that is in a class of the scotogenic models. And to end with the conclusion and some expectation that may make this model a little bit interesting for future exploration with, for instance, observatories that could be here in the north part of Chile. So in that sense, everything we have to start with the whole, and in this sense, for particle physics, the whole would be the standard model. In any case, the standard model is a very strong phenomenological model that is based on symmetries, and this what is make more interesting about the model is the capability to make prediction and to be observed in several type of observable from astroparticle physics, at collider physics, also and everything else. So in that sense, we already know that the basis symmetries of the standard model are Lorentz symmetry and the gauge symmetries related with color, isospin, and hyperchange. We know the family matter, the contents in three families of quarks, leptons, so on and so forth. And we have a very complete picture of everything that is observable in the universe. But as all models, it's not completely, it doesn't explain everything. For instance, gravity is not included in the current description of the standard model. But at the end, there are other aspects that also are not included in the standard model. One of these cases that is, let's say, an evidence of physics beyond the standard model is the case of dark matter. Dark matter, we already know, is quite a very nice hypothesis that is expressed in many different scales, galactic scale, extragalactic plane, cosmological scales, that is an amount of gravitational matter that is present that we can observe via the dynamics of cluster of galaxies, structure formation, CMB astrotropy, by oscillation, that there is a large fraction of the matter of the universe, around 85% of the matter of the universe is in the form of dark matter. And of course, this kind of matter is not contained in the current description of the standard model. This large amount of dark matter is not in the standard model. But nevertheless, this place the standard model and the observable universe in a very nice situation because we already know part of the universe, that is just 5% of the matter of the universe, is known matter or ordinary matters. And all the rest is the dark matter that must be in some way like an extension or living in an extension of the standard model. So in that sense, we are quite confident that this hypothesis that there is a part of the matter of the universe that this is not explained or is not contained in the standard model, that makes a very nice hypothesis to be tested and to try to discover the nature of this type of matter. So we already know that from the point of view of cosmology, we already have like 0.11 is the relic abundance of the dark matter, and this is the number that we want to obtain in any model that we want to have and in which we have a dark matter candidate. So in that sense, the same connection in the whole picture of the universe that everything happens after the Big Bang, we have the connection that the same processes that participates in the early universe to generate the relic abundance of dark matter can be used to trace back and to try to observe or to find evidence of these particles that are lying around us. So in that sense, we have this beyond the relic abundance constraint of the amount of dark matter that there is in the universe, we have different search strategies like indirect detection that we wait for dark matter particles to annihilate living in galactic halos, and this give us cosmic rays or gamma rays, et cetera, neutrinos. This is a way to look for dark matter. The second wave could be direct detection, that is to wait for dark matter to interact with very sensitive detector in underground mines, underground laboratories. Particle collider, that in that sense, we are not producing dark matter. I mean, we could produce dark matter, but we are not gonna be able to observe dark matter in the collider, but we can observe particles associated to the context of dark matter. For instance, in the old times when there were supersymmetry was a kind of fashion, there were neutralinos like a good dark matter candidate, but neutralinos were not be, I mean, wouldn't be observed in colliders, but could be observed the charginos. So in that sense, you can find the other parts of the framework in which dark matter, the dark matter candidate can be embedded. And of course, we have other astrophysical proofs like interaction of dark matter with dark matter that could modify how the galactic or dark matter halos, the shape of the dark matter halo. So in that sense, the other part of the talk is related with neutrinos. We already know that neutrinos are super interesting particles, especially because in the standard model, predicts that neutrinos are completely massless particles. But we already know that it's quite established that neutrino oscillation implies that neutrinos has to be massive and has to be mixed in a precise way or relatively precise way between different flavors of neutrinos and with the relative neutrino mass state. So in that sense, dark matter from one side and neutrino physics, neutrino oscillation are... somebody is talking on. Okay, anyway. What I'm saying that neutrino, dark matter and neutrino are, for the moment, very interesting proofs that the standard model must be extended and we need to explain it and to find which is, could be the next step in the evolution of the different models in particle physics. So just a very fast review of how to generate mass in neutrinos. Basically, in the standard model, neutrino masses are possible, but you have to introduce dimension 5 operator that is called Weinberg operator, and this is going to break one of the symmetry that is expected or we wanted to more or less is an accidental symmetry in the standard model, that is the lepton number. Anyway, with this Weinberg operator that is not a renormalizable operator, you're going to generate Majorana neutrino masses, and therefore you can assume that if neutrinos are massive, lepton number is not a symmetry of the standard model because it has to be broken in 2 units. Nevertheless, we can explore what are the implication of breaking lepton number, and we can get at the minimal, with the minimal amount of new fields, the so-called seesaw mechanism in which we can have the type 1, type 2, and type 3. That is basically, in the type 1, you add a right-handed neutrino, in the type 3, you add a SU2 triplet without hypercharge Majorana fermion, and in the type 2, you add a SU2 triplet with hypercharge that is a Higgs-like, but with triplet in the sense of SU2. So in that sense, all these three models are the minimal versions of the minimal realization of how to give mass to neutrinos, or in some way, how to generate the Weinberg operator, completing the model in a more regular way with dimension 5, dimension 4 terms. So in that sense, beyond the seesaw mechanism that are mechanisms at 3 level, there are the so-called radiative seesaw in which you can generate neutrino masses in terms of loop correction to the neutrino propagator. And in that sense, one of the subclasses of radiative seesaw is the so-called scotogenic model. The scotogenic model is a very nice concept because you are trying to generate neutrino masses, but in order to be the loop process to be the one that are dominant, you need to add an extra symmetry. In this case, the simplest extra symmetry you can add is a Z2, a discrete symmetry. But the effect of this Z2 symmetry evoked to give mass to neutrino produce that particles inside the loop are particles that which are stable. And if you have a neutral particle inside your loop, this neutral particle could be a good dark matter candidate. And this is what is the nice connection between dark matter and neutrino in the context of these models that are called, are known scotogenic models. So scotogenic models, you can have different flavors. You can use like base the same fields of the type one CISO, but in a loop level, and it's known like scotogenic type one. You can create this scotogenic type two using the SU2 triplet fermion in the center. And you're gonna have different kind of dark matter candidate, like the neutral fermion, the CP even or CP odd scalars that are running here inside the loop. And in the case of the type three, you have the neutral part of the SU2 triplet, also the other two. So in that sense, these are very nice models and very elegant models how to connect dark matter phenomenology with neutrino models. And in this sense, we in the work that we did with Matthias Pierre, we wanted to extend in a fashion to take like a base, the type two minimal CISO, and try to generate a scotogenic model. And in that sense, the only possibility to realize this model is basically you have to extend your standard model with new particles charged with this set two symmetry in which case you have to add a scalar triplet with hypercharge, a scalar triplet with hypercharge, and this is also connected in some sense with some talks that we have at the early in the week. And you have to add a vector-like doublet fermion that is nice, especially for collider physics, because vector-like fermions are very interesting. So at this point, you're gonna have different dark matter candidate, the CP even scalar, the CP odd scalar, and the Dirac fermion that is gonna be different from the other case. And in that sense, in this scenario, you can see here the charge assignment just to how to make everything work together in a consistent way.
Sorry, you have five minutes.
Perfect. So in that sense, the important part here is, in principle, we have three dark matter candidates, but after taking into account the construction in terms of the charges, assignment, et cetera, the only dark matter candidate that has the model is the CP even scalar. That is gonna be very interesting because you don't have ambiguity which of the three possible dark matter candidates you can have. You only can have the CP even scalar in this model. So, okay, the model, the scalar potential is gonna be a little bit messy because there are two triplets plus the Higgs doublet is gonna be a lot of terms to deal with the scalar potential and also to take into account vacuum of stability and other fashion inside the model. But from the point of view of the neutrino masses, it's very elegant because the model, the minimal model, the one that I'm presenting, it only can generate two neutrino masses different from zero, and one is gonna be completely massless. This connects in a very nice with the, for instance, with the normal ordering for the neutrino masses. And also it can explain you can adjust the mixing angles between the neutrino state. So if you want to understand or study how dark matter is produced in the early universe and also how we can observe dark matter, you have to analyze the annihilation channel that dark matter has during the whole history. But in principle, these annihilation channels also are nice for the indirect detection sources. So in that sense, already here is a scan with taking into account relic abundance and all the neutrino physics constraint and vacuum stability constraint. We can get very nice feature. For instance, your dark matter candidate lies between the 700 GeV and 330 GeV. The annihilation into W channel, that is the one that I'm presenting here, is in the right spot for the future CTA. That is gonna be here in Cerro Paranal, close to us. On the other case, if you analyze the annihilation channel into tau leptons, this is a feature that has this model, that is the annihilation cross-section also is in the reach of CTA, so in the future also could be tested. And because of the connection with neutrino physics, dark matter also annihilates in a large quantity into neutrinos that could be observed in the future KM3NET neutrino observatory that is gonna be in the Mediterranean Sea. So just to finish with the talk, there are also ways to look for the matter at this, in this case with direct detection. And in direct detection, we have a very nice perspective for this model because you can see here that it's xenon 1 ton, this is data that is already taken. So in that sense, our model, we can in some sense neglect this part in the top, but in the future, in the following 2 years, Darwin is going to start running and taking data. So in principle, all our model could be also tested in this Rachel parameter. And therefore, we can look for complementarity in target detection at the level of Darwin, but also with indirect detection at the level of CTA and KM3Net. So in that sense, just to finish with my talk, just to present that these two observables of these two sides of the coin in this model, that is neutrino observables and dark matter observables, are very nice ways to look for new physics lying around, because as we are here in this workshop of the part and the whole, here we are dealing with two aspects that are very complementary. See, some mechanisms are very, in some sense, elegant to connect the two sides, the neutrino and dark matter. Of course, experiments are going to tell us if scotogenic models is a good model for continue to expand in the standard model. And of course, this model is just a realization that the type 2 CISO in this scenario. But above all, the complementarity between the CTA, KM3Net, and Darwin is going to be key in order to explain the model. So thank you very much. And if you have a question, I'm here.
Okay, thank you a lot, Roberto. Questions, we have questions. Okay, Joanna Cotin, please.
Oh, hi, Roberto. Sorry, I arrived a little bit later to your talk, but I missed maybe the motivation for your extension for including this vector-like fermion to the scotogenic model. Do you want to escape some bounds for dark matter researches or something?
Yeah, here in the scan, basically we include relic abundant constraints, already neutrino masses constraints, because the Yukawa coupling cannot be any value because you have to reproduce the neutrino bounds. And of course, the vacuum stability and minimal searches like charged particle has to be higher than 120 or 150, depending on the type, because since here we have dealing with triplets, they're they're better constrainable by colliders, not like singlets or something like that. So in that sense, it's very interesting because all the implication for also for colliders, and especially the presence of vector-like doublet fermion that we don't have to deal with we have a mass value for those particles that could be ranging very high. And indeed, this model, since you have triplet and doublet, lies in the region of the TeV scale more than other scotogenic models that tend to be in the range of the 100 GeV scale, especially if there are singlets. In order to explain the relic abundance, here we have the push of the W boson and the Z boson.
Okay, so in that sense, it's collider mode, but for the collider rich phenomenology that you would get with these additional states. And on the other hand, you can be safe with higher dark matter masses.
Yes.
That is okay.
Yeah, the other motivation, I mean, this model has a lot of motivation. No, not a lot of motivation, but it's nice to look for the, because there are not so many models of dark matter in the range of the TeV with dark matter. I mean, decay dark matter could be more, there are more models, but in the WIMP dark matter, it's very hard to get a WIMP consistent model in the TeV scale. There are minimal dark matter scenario, but you have to add quintuplet or septuplet.
Right.
That's the point that to be a part of, in some sense, the delta scalar that you have here is double charged, so it's very nice for the point of view of the collider, but of course, you have to produce at the TeV scale, that this could be a little bit challenging for current LHB, LHC.
Thanks.
We have another question of Jose Luis Cortez. Please go ahead.
Are there upper bounds on the masses of the additional particles that you add to the standard model?
Here in this model, in principle, you have upper bounds related with the stronger upper bound are coming from the dark matter relic abundance. But if you deal this, okay, I don't care about the dark matter abundance. You're going to have, in principle, constraints related with the very high masses. The vacuum stability could be a challenge for the model, but you have to go beyond the TeV scale. You have to do hundreds of TeV, or also you're going to have to start to have problem with the unitarity constraints or the non-perturbativity of the model. So your scalar potential in order to fit the data, you need to have cappings larger than the square root of 4 pi, and this put problem for the point of view of perturbation, perturbativity calculation. But in general, it's in this range, in the TEV, it's kind of okay. Of course, all the implication for higher masses, we didn't explore this because we already, the relic abundance is putting you a strong constraint under neutrino physics that you cannot go larger than 30 TeV. And this is a point that, I mean, from the point of view, if you want to explain the whole amount of dark matter with this model, it gives you a dead end at 30 TeV. If you say that, okay, my model doesn't produce 100% dark matter, just a 50% or 10%, arguing that there is another dark matter candidate to fulfill the rest of the relic abundance, you can extend it to large values.